Damon Gamo. This is my weatherboard house. This is a time lapse of my girlfriend's pregnancy. There's 3 months to go. And this is a photo of me at age 10. I was a rare boy whose face grew into his teeth. 5 years ago, when I met my girlfriend, I was pretty much living on cigarettes, sugar, and my homemade Australian pizzas. But then, as men often do, they feign interest in things to impress a girl. For me, it was healthy eating. I actually cut out refined sugar from my diet to seal the deal. But now sugar is dominating the headlines. And there's so much debate and conjecture on the topic that it's hard to know what to believe. But with this little person on the way, I feel like I need some definitive answers.
If the average Australian family of four had to buy the sugar they are consuming in a week, they would be going to the supermarket, taking 6 1-kilo bags of sugar off the shelves, six, taking it home, eating it all that week, then going back next week and doing it again.
Clearly, the ability to be on a high-sugar diet is really new, especially in terms of evolutionary time zone.
Sugar has become so prevalent in today's society that if you removed all the items containing it from a standard supermarket's shelves, just 20% of items would remain.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, this is the condensed history of sugar. The first reports of sugar came from New Guinea in 8000 BC. Local mythology says that the human race came about after a man made love to the stalk of a sugar cane. Then, by a trade of migration routes, the cane made its way to India. In the 12th century, sugar arrived in Europe, and due to its rarity, it quickly became a status symbol for royalty. Queen Elizabeth I had a real love of sugar. So much so that her teeth rotted and went black from it. Yeah. At the start of the 20th century, sugar was still seen as a treat, something you would add to a cup of tea or a cup of coffee. But then in 1955, an event occurred that significantly influenced the amount of sugar we eat today.
Our stunned nation hears that its president is stricken with a heart attack at the...
On September the 23rd, 1955, the US President Dwight Eisenhower suffered a heart attack, and the issue of heart disease was thrust into the public domain.
Summoned to the hospital, a famed Boston heart specialist...
Two strong theories emerged. One, led by an American scientist named Ansel Keys, who declared that fat was the problem, while a British doctor named John Yudkin believed sugar was to blame.
I'd be very happy if everybody had 4 pounds of sugar a year. They eat 100 pounds.
Over the next two decades, the discussion brought fierce arguments from both camps. But by the end of the 1970s, Ansel Keys had won out. Fat became the villain, sugar was exonerated, and the low-fat movement was in full swing.
we institutionalize this idea that a low-fat diet is a healthy diet. So what you want to do is remove fats. This is how industry perceives this. We're going to remove fat from otherwise healthy foods. And when we do this, we have to replace the calories. We have to make sure we have the right mouthfeel. And it has to taste as good as it did with fat. And the best way to do that is with sugar.
With sugar now saturating our food supply and the constant confusion over its effects on our health, the only real way to get some answers is for me to start eating sugar again and see what it does to my body. So the first step is to set up an experiment with the help of a team of experts. My chief sugar advisor is the author David Gillespie, aka the Crusader. In charge of my blood tests is one of Australia's leading clinical pathologists, Dr. Ken Zakaris, aka Professor Blood. My nutritionist is Sharon Johnson, the Celtic food queen. And supervising my overall health is Dr. Debbie Herbst, aka Checkups.
Okay, so I want to do this mission. I want to find out what sugar does to me. What kind of things do I need to do?
If you want to match Australian averages, mm-hmm. you're going to have to be in the range 40 teaspoons of sugar a day.
40 a day?
Yeah, 40 a day. That's what's embedded in most of the processed food that most people are eating.
So, right, so does that mean I'm going to eat a lot of these kind of sour rainbow blowpipes? I mean, is that, how am I going to get to 40 teaspoons?
You won't need to come near a place like this to get to 40 teaspoons. You just go to a supermarket and you'll get to 40 teaspoons.
Right. The point is to test out a very high sugar diet and to see what effects we get, what changes I notice in the body. 2 months, I want to eat 40 teaspoons of sugar a day.
40 teaspoons?
40 teaspoons.
Ooh. How are you going to do that?
Off the shelf breakfast cereals, like Just Right, low-fat flavoured yogurt. Another good one would be some beans on toast.
It's baked beans?
One serving of a iced tea, you'll end up with nearly 9 teaspoons of sugar.
If I can achieve 40 teaspoons a day without touching perceived candy or junk food, I mean, I can't quite fathom that's possible, but if we can do that and see some changes, then that's, yeah, that seems like a pretty good story.
A lot of your health markers are going to be going in very much the wrong direction. Mm. And I'm very glad to hear that you're going to be having some medical supervision, because I think you're going to need it.
Anyone in the family with diabetes?
No.
Not
that I know of.
Not that you know of. Good, and heart disease?
No. All pretty thin and wiry Irish or French folk.
We're going to look at how the blood sugar changes, obviously. We've got blood tests that can look at the effect of the heart, but even more than that, we're looking for the changes that might occur in the liver and its production of fat.
I'd like to go to 1932, please.
Done.
Blood pressure 121 over 79, and your heart rate's pretty good at 75, so that's pretty good. Alrighty, so we'll just have a listen to your heart, see, mm-hmm. see what it sounds like. You know what it's saying, Damon.
Don't do this crazy
thing. Exactly, that's exactly what I heard, isn't it?
There are some tests that we're doing just to make sure that you're not doing anything too stupid here.
Usually I'm telling people not to eat all this sort of stuff, so.
I personally think you're insane for doing it at all, but no, honestly, I think it's dangerous. But I guess on the plus side, everybody else is already doing it.
So this is where my health stands pre-experiment. My total calorie intake is approximately 2,300 a day, with 50% coming from good fats like avocado and nuts, 26% from proteins such as eggs, meat or fish, and 24% from carbohydrates, like fresh vegetables. And of course, there is no refined sugar. I currently weigh 76 kilograms with a waist circumference of 84 centimetres. My blood tests showed a very healthy liver, a very low level of triglyceride, which is fat in the bloodstream, and thankfully no sign of insulin resistance or diabetes. Overall, I rated slightly healthier than the average Western male of my age. The next step in the experiment was to do a shop. To calculate my 40 teaspoons, I need to keep in mind that one teaspoon equals roughly 4 grams of sugar. But I also need a lesson in the different types of sugar.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it's time to meet the sugar family. When we eat certain foods, they adhere to a rule. They break down to glucose, which our body uses for fuel. Breads, pasta, veggies, and grains all turn to glucose to be used by our brain. But also our cells and our organs, too. So without any glucose, there would be no you. Lactose is next, and she's as smooth as silk. She's the first sugar mammals have. It's in their mother's milk. You'll find it in cheese and milk and tubs of yogurt, too. But take care if you're intolerant. You'll be rushing to the loo. Now, sucrose is the sugar that all the fuss is about. Some say it's dangerous, while others still have doubt. Sucrose is the table sugar we have in coffee or tea. She's the sugar family's sweet little daughter. Or not, apparently. Now, this table sugar, or sucrose, is made up of two sugars. It is 50% glucose, the head of the family, plus 50% fructose. Now, fructose may well be the sugar family's mischievous teenage son, because in the past, this fructose was very, very rare. It was found in fruits and veggies and honey, if you dared. But now we find it everywhere, in so many foods we eat. And you'll always know if you're eating fructose, because it's the thing that makes food sweet. You see, people on this planet are growing sicker every day. And many scientists now believe that fructose has a role to play.
The first load. Why don't we make these middle shelves the sugar zone?
I love it.
Yeah, some juicy juice. Yeah.
Juice boxes, babe.
Yep.
Up and go.
So here are the rules for my next 60 days. I must consume 40 teaspoons of sugar a day, but they must be hidden sugars, found in commonly perceived healthy foods and drinks. So no soft drink, chocolate, confectionery, or ice cream. These 40 teaspoons of sugar will consist of sucrose and fructose specifically. They can be added, like jam, or naturally occurring, like sultanas. I must always choose low-fat foods and maintain the same level of exercise as I already do. That's 3 laps of my garden twice a week and a 10-minute workout on my homemade gym. And by homemade, I mean homemade.
Tomorrow morning, I start. What are your feelings?
I hope you're okay.
Darling, do we have a metric cup, like, to measure size?
Yep.
Right, so this just right tells me that it's 12 grams of sugar per serving, right? So that's divided by 4, that's roughly 3 teaspoons of sugar per serving. That's a recommended serving size, with 3 teaspoons of sugar.
Now, I don't know about you, but I'm a growing boy. I'm gonna need a little bit more of that. That feels like a shot of just right.
Yeah, maybe 2.5. Okay, so 2.5. So 1 was just under 3 teaspoons, 2 is 6 teaspoons, another half is about 7.5 teaspoons of sugar just in that bowl. I added the yogurt yet. Per serving, there is 27 grams, but a lot of that's going to be lactose, so I reckon 18 grams. 18 divided by 4 is just over 4. So 4 to my 7, so there's 11 teaspoons of sugar, and then I've got to add my juice. I'm going to put about 400 mils of apple juice, that'll do me. There, we're looking at 9 teaspoons. So this combined, I'm looking at nearly 20 teaspoons to start the day.
Hi, David, how are you going?
Good, how are you?
But I just had a quick question. We just I just sort of had my first breakfast and I got to about 20 teaspoons.
20 teaspoons?
I almost couldn't believe it, but I did all the maths and it just seems ridiculous.
Mate, you're going to have to be on a diet for the rest of the day if you're only allowed to have 20 teaspoons for the rest of the day.
That's what I mean. I'm going to have to eat celery for the rest of the day. Just obscene.
When we were still foraging and hunting and gathering and trying to search for fruit and things in our environment, we needed to be highly attuned to what sweetness there was because we really need the calories. And of course now we bring with us that ancient lust for sugar, the ability to find even small amounts, and it's a case where we were looking for a little but now we have too much. And so the system in an evolutionary terms is not really set up to deal with this sudden abundance of highly refined sugar.
After just 2 days of the experiment, I was amazed at how easy it was to get to 40 teaspoons without eating any junk food.
I've just had a breakthrough as to how we might be consuming so much fructose. I just bought these 4 apples. Now I know that if I tried to eat these apples, I'd probably get through 2 of them and I'd feel full. The fiber in the fruit would tell my body to stop. It's had enough to eat. But I want to see what happens if I can juice these 4 apples. Right, so that's 4 apples. That's the sugar from 4 apples in 1 glass. Now, 1 apple is about 4 teaspoons of sugar, so that's 16 teaspoons of sugar in that glass. See, nature has given us this perfect little packet. And it's got all the nutrients, the fiber that tells us when we're full, and just the right amount of sugar in this. But what we do is we invent a machine like this, which extracts only the sugar, and then we throw everything else away.
This high amount of sugar in juice, and drinks in general, was certainly the biggest surprise of the first week.
Beverage tend to really create a rush, what I kind of call a tsunami effect. So you basically have this huge wave of sugar that gets to your liver, and that has a lot of consequence.
It was now day 12, and time for my first weigh-in.
Moment of truth. 79.3. Huh?
I'm about to cry.
What?
3.2 kilos.
In 12 days.
In 12 days.
And that's without 1 fizzy drink, no ice cream, no chocolate. That is eating healthy food.
It's alarming. I guess it's...
Debbie's alarm wasn't about the amount of weight I had gained. It was the fact that it was all around my belly. This is what's known as visceral fat.
I'm having a baby!
Here's a great example of it. On this person, the fat comes up as black. You can see there is a very small amount of fat just under the skin, but lots of visceral fat on the inside, cramping the organs. There is a term for this, toffee. Thin on the outside, fat on the inside.
We know that with fructose, you tend to accumulate more fat in this area. We don't know why, but we know on the other hand that when you do accumulate that fat in this area, you have a lot of metabolic disease that are associated with this.
On day 15, it occurred to me what 40 teaspoons of sugar would actually look like, stripped of its cleverly marketed packaging.
Today, I'm going to eat 40 actual teaspoons of sugar. Just Right low-fat yogurt. There's 10 teaspoons of sugar. Here, just a bowl of plain Vita Wheats. So what I'm going to do, this now equals that.
It's time for my mid-morning snack. Now, I could have this amount of frozen yogurt, or 11. So it's lunch. I have this delicious piece of chicken here. Now I could add half a packet of this teriyaki chicken sauce, or alternatively, now to wash it down, I could have one of these, or I'll take the sweet, you can take the sound. Every single minute, every single hour. So it's the mid-afternoon slump. Now, as a pick-me-up, I could have this Go Natural Superfood Apple Strawberry Cranberry Ripple Bar, or I could have this 7-teaspoon water cracker sugar sandwich. It was at this point that I thought I'd better check in with Professor Blood.
The big change is that the liver function tests have had an amazing rise in one of the enzyme levels, the ALT level. The ALT is an enzyme in the liver which helps the reactions go out. If it appears in your blood, because that's where we measured it, it shows that the liver cells are releasing their contents, i.e. they're being damaged or dying. And so it's really...
My liver cells are dying.
They are. It's obviously getting full of fat. You've got the signs of a fatty liver. And this is really the first time I've actually seen that it can be actually developed in 2 or 3 weeks.
Great. Given my liver has turned to fat after just 18 days, I think it's time to take a closer look at what sugar does once it enters the body. This is the actor Brenton Thwaites. He's very kindly volunteered his body for the following demonstration.
After sugar enters the body, it splits into two parts, fructose and glucose, both of which make their way to the liver.
Now, once in the liver, the glucose is dealt with efficiently. It's either used immediately for energy, or it's stored for later, like a spare battery. But the fructose half of sugar is very different. The liver doesn't have a system to regulate the fructose because it was so rare in nature. So it hoovers it out of the bloodstream whether it needs it or not. And if all our spare batteries are full, then it rapidly turns it into fat.
Some of that fat is going to stay in the liver, and you're going to have increased risk for insulin resistance and diabetes.
What also happens is that this fat in the liver is then sent out into the bloodstream as triglycerides, which can lead to excess weight, plus blocked arteries and heart disease. Now, when we're eating lots of sugar and other carbohydrates like bread and pasta, we're producing lots of glucose. A hormone called insulin is released, which is like a key that helps to open our cells' doors so they can absorb all the glucose, remove it from the bloodstream, and burn it for energy. The more glucose in the blood, the more insulin is released. But the key point for us is that while this insulin is in the blood dealing with all the glucose, it tells our fat cells to hold on to the fat. It actually turns off our fat-burning processes. So when we're eating lots of sugar, we're putting fat into our bodies via the fatty liver. Plus, because of all the glucose, we maintain the level of insulin, which tells our fat cells to hold on to the fat. We can't burn off fat when insulin is around dealing with all the sugar. This is what may be happening to a huge number of the population. It's highly unlikely with Brenton, though.
The issue that we're talking about is that there are these chronic diseases related to obesity and diabetes, heart disease, many cancers, gout, hypertension, high blood pressure, possibly Alzheimer's disease. The question is, would these diseases exist if sugar wasn't in the diet?
So this morning I've woken up and I feel pretty drained. I had a chicken dish last night that was pretty sweet. And I could just tell that my body feels lethargic and it's waiting for its next sugar injection. So the perfectly named Up and Go is going to start my day today. Banana flavoured with about 4 to 5 teaspoons of sugar.
It was obvious that sugar was affecting me physically, but the real surprise was the impact it was having on my moods.
It's amazing, it's so sweet, and I can feel my brain responds to it straight away, like it tastes delicious.
The thing I've noticed the most is the mood swings, big highs when I have the sugar and I feel super alert and switched on for about 45 minutes.
Yes.
And then I'll get this feeling of real lethargy. I'll feel vague, a bit aloof, until I get that next hit again, and then I'm right to concentrate.
I just noticed the attention is reduced and is much more distracted. And it's very unlike him, very unusual.
What you're describing is absolutely what the research has shown. There's a high concentration, energy, followed by a crash.
The brain and body runs on glucose. If the glucose level is going constantly up and down, you know, zinging high and low and high and low and back and forth, then your mental function is just unstable. If your glucose level is stable and not fluctuating, then you have more clarity.
It's almost like the body is getting used to this new reality that I've created, and and it gets its burst of energy from the sugar.
Yes.
And then when that's not happening, it's like going, okay, we're ready. Like, I guess I used to smoke, it's a similar feeling.
Tell me a little bit more about what it's like when you've just had some sugar and when you're on the sugar high.
Quite a childish thing comes out in me, like, and then I'm full of beans for a while.
He can be like that in, you know, day-to-day life, who's really fun and playful. But the difference is there's a kind of manic edge to it that wasn't there before. It's kind of a bit more like, ah!
Now, the manic state is quite interesting because it's not the same as happiness, right? There's a sort of a sense of being wired.
It's raining sugar!
So it's interesting because that's a thing that we do see, and of course I'm not suggesting you've got bipolar disorder, but it's a phenomena that we see in that particular condition where there's a very high mood, but it's not actually a very pleasant mood.
So, Damon, the way that blood sugar affects your mood, I like to explain to people with a really simple diagram. So this is your blood sugar levels here. This is the point where your brain is really happy because it's got enough sugar to keep it going. It is your most important organ in the body in that way. When you eat something that's really sugary, like lollies or fruit juices, that sort of thing, your blood sugar will spike really quickly. And then it will crash down again really quickly. The reason it crashes really quickly is because in response to that sugar, the body releases insulin, the hormone, that takes it into the cells so it can be used for energy. So that big crash, though, means that your brain's no longer happy. So in response to that, we get the release of stress hormones like adrenaline, which is then signalling the brain to tell you to eat something sugary
again,
so that we can get it back up again.
Wow.
And so once again, we get more insulin and it dips down. And that's why you get the fluctuations in your mood from that sugar spiking and falling. And the problem with the adrenaline is that that can lead to anxiety and even panic attacks because of those mood changes.
Given my experience of fluctuating blood sugar levels, I couldn't help but think of children struggling to learn at school. Could a diet full of hidden sugar be contributing to the problem?
This has had a very profound impact on children's behavior, on mental illness. It has exacerbated many different types of neurological disorders, but we don't actually name what the cause is, which is the sugar that's in the diet.
Sugar Crisp is candy-coated right down to the last wheat puff in the box.
As a cereal, it's dandy.
For snacks, it's so handy.
Or eat it like candy.
Post Sugar Crisp.
Don't laugh, it's for the... You know why I'm doing it.
The speed at which my high-sugar diet was affecting me took us all by surprise. I was going to have to expand the scope of the experiment, and this would take me out of town for a few days. In 2002, I spent some time with an Aboriginal community and was stunned by the amount of sugar they consumed. Like so many Indigenous cultures introduced to a Western diet, their relationship with sugar seemed particularly destructive.
The Aborigines have remarkably little sugar in their diet. Two or three small pieces of candy would be equal to the sum total of the amount of sweetness that an Aborigine would get in 1 year.
In 2008, Coca-Cola claimed that Australia's Northern Territory was their highest-selling region per capita in the world. This was in large part due to the local stores in the Aboriginal communities. Just 100 kilometres from Uluru is the small town of Armata. It has always been alcohol-free, but in 2007, its population of just under 400 people consumed 40,000 litres of soft drink. So one Aboriginal man decided to do something about it. His name is John Tregenza. This is his case, this is his puturu, and this is his nickname. Why?
Because I cut through the bullshit. When I first came up here in 1973, I would estimate that, say, 10% of the people's diet came from the store. And now it's almost 100%. So it was obviously critical that people's health depended on what they were coming out the store door.
This reliance on the store has been caused by a variety of environmental changes, the main one being the introduction of a foreign grass that took over the plains and drove away the native plants and animals that had provided bush tucker for centuries. Being in Armata, it was hard to believe that only 40 years ago, these people were living predominantly off the land.
All our families, old people, all our grandfathers and great-great-parents, they're only eating bush tuckers like emus, kangaroos, turkey, wild tomatoes, wild pigs. And they were healthy, no sickness. And then the white fella come into Australia. He bring all the sweet things like lollies, biscuit, everything.
With stores filling up with highly profitable sugary items and the community's health rapidly declining, John, his colleagues and a local health council established a program to ensure people had access to fresh, healthy produce. They called it May Wiru. The May Wiru quickly went to work. They removed deep fryers, added free cold water fountains, and hired a nutritionist to educate the community. For the children, they made music videos with psychedelic vegetables and put up these signs on the store's fridges. I put this one to the test, and I think they might be onto something. But most importantly, the local people were empowered and began making their own decisions about their health.
The community at Armada decided that they wanted to reduce the amount of sugar intake that they were having throughout the community.
The first high sugar item to go was the black fizzy stuff.
So they've said, we don't want Coke, so they don't have Coke. So no one is upset about it. It is a decision by the elders, and so we don't have Coke.
May Wiru was working, and in a very short time, Armata had the lowest rate of sugar consumption in the region.
With the level of sugar consumption in other communities I've been in, it's astronomical. It is over the top. I think the May Wiru group in itself could teach a lot of the other communities a lot.
But just when everything seemed to be headed in the right direction, the government slashed May Wiru's funding.
The organisation is now left with the skeleton of staff. The nutritionist was the first to go. The people that are younger than that are people really feel it because it was their idea. Like, they're the ones who saw the problem. They're the ones who bury their own people. They're the ones who want to make a change. And they've been totally ignored, overridden, and had funding taken off by federal and state governments and given to non-Aboriginal organisations. It's really quite outrageous.
The thing that struck me about Armata is that although Coke is gone, without a nutritionist to continue the education, people are still consuming vast amounts of sugar in other products. And their health is suffering as a consequence.
There's a perception abroad that the problems with obesity and diabetes may be related to alcohol, but here at Armada it's been a dry community ever since it was established. So all of the health problems, including diabetes and kidney failure, is all related to the diet.
John offered to take me to a special place where the full effects of a disabled May Wiru can be felt.
I've known almost everyone buried here. I've got family members buried here. These five graves here are all people under 40. That's another young person in there. Whole group up here of two sisters and a brother who all passed away from kidney failure. Most of these deaths here are premature and could have been avoided with correct diet and access to affordable, healthy food. It's a complete tragedy.
After 4 days in Armata, it occurred to me that what is happening to my body is perhaps a concentrated version of what has happened here and in many other Indigenous communities. I'd been sugar-free for a long time, and now, by suddenly subjecting myself to a high-sugar diet, the effects have been both rapid and acute. If immediate action isn't taken to restore the positive direction that Mayawiru was heading in, then the oldest living culture on Earth is in great danger of disappearing.
Oh, look at that. 81.2.
81.2. Okay, so what's that in...
1.6.
So how in a month I've put on 5.
Something like that. Yeah.
76.
You started out at 76. Yeah. Over 5 kilos. Oh, my God.
What? Hang on, is that a... Hang on, that's, don't tell me.
91.
91. So, okay, seven centimetres.
If I kept going for the next 3 or 4 months at these levels, would I be knocking on the door of obesity?
Definitely. You haven't got far to go.
I'm eating a lot more than I would. I'm snacking a lot more than I would have before. I find it very hard to feel full.
Not surprising, because you're not eating very much good fats or proteins. It's the fat and the protein that actually helps us feel fuller. All the low-fat foods that we've been told are good for us and that we should be eating actually tend to be higher in sugar anyway, as you know, and they're not helping us to feel full.
With the effects of sugar now clearly taking a toll on me,
Hello.
And having witnessed its devastation in Armita,
back in.
I needed to talk to some people that knew a lot more about the subject than I did.
Behind you, hanging off my cupboard door.
It was time to head to the cultural capital of convenience, the mecca of the processed food and sugar industry, and the current number one ranked world obesity champion.
Look out, America. Here comes Sugar Daddy. So much larger than life.
We're here in America, day one, jet lag. So I just went into Jumba Juice and got me one of these. 139 grams of sugar. I actually need the calculator for this. That is 34 teaspoons of sugar in that drink. That is nearly my daily allowance in this cup. What a great jet lag cure. Wow.
Now, if I was to eat the same amount of sugar that was in that smoothie, but the sugar was in its original fruit packaging, I would have to eat 4 peaches, 9 limes, 30 lemons, and 30 strawberries. This might be fine for a bear about to go into hibernation, but it can have damaging effects for a human who thinks they are making a healthy choice.
One of the interesting conflicts today is this idea that, pushed by some of our government, well-meaning government officials, that if you could just get Coca-Colas out of McDonald's and get the kids to drink fruit smoothies, they'd be healthier, and yet the fruit smoothies have just as much sugar as the Coca-Cola.
The first thing I noticed with American foods was how difficult it was going to be to stay under 40 teaspoons. It wasn't just the abundance of sugar in the food, but also the presence of a sweetener called high fructose corn syrup. Its primary delivery system is soft drink, which adds roughly 4,000 teaspoons a year to the diet of each American.
People don't actually realize that high fructose corn syrup and sugar are virtually identical. The corn refiners back in the 1980s did their best to make sure that people didn't equate high fructose corn syrup with sugar. Flash forward 20 years later, people are blaming high fructose corn syrup for the obesity epidemic. Mm. And now the corn refiners are desperately trying to say that they are sugar. They're no different than sugar. And the sugar industry is going, no, you're not. They're entirely different.
Turbinado, fruit juice concentrate.
With sugar and high fructose corn syrup now in the spotlight, I notice that companies are using a range of seductive names for other fructose-based sweeteners.
Agave.
Any sugar, brown sugar, white sugar, high fructose corn syrup, fruit juice concentrate from fruit juice, equal effect on your health.
Not feeling very well at all today. Nauseous in my stomach and had a headache all morning. And it's interesting because we're driving through rural America now, we're in North Carolina.
Oh, my kingdom's sinking and I don't know what to do.
It's so hard to get any kind of decent food. There are signs that say food exit, but that food is either McDonald's or Taco Bell or KFC. It's impossible. And if you grow up as a kid and this is your only experience of food and what food is, it's little wonder that there's a massive problem in this country.
Next stop was Barberville, Kentucky. In the great cola wars of the 1990s, Pepsi and Coke were engaged in a fierce battle. The Pepsi Army took a strong foothold in the state of Kentucky. And their number one sniper is the drink Mountain Dew. In this 1.25-litre bottle, you'll find 37 teaspoons of sugar and 40% more caffeine than the same size bottle of Coke. The people of Kentucky have understandably had some problems with their teeth. And one dentist is doing something about it. His name is Edwin Smith. This is his letterbox, this is his daughter, and this is him as a collectible figurine. Edwin drives around the state of Kentucky in RVs he has converted into mobile dental clinics. He and his team visit schools, educate the kids, and treat their teeth.
Early in my practice, I saw these patients that would have this unusual decay, brown decay around the gum line, usually the front teeth. Most of these people were addicted to Mountain Dew in particular, and that's where we came up with the term Mountain Dew mouth. I've talked to some kids who say they may drink 10 a day. They started drinking it so early that they don't know when they started.
Mountain Dew will tickle your innards because there's a bang in every bottle.
They take the lid off, they take a drink. 20 minutes or so, it starts to wear off, and they take another drink. It takes the oral cavity about 20 minutes to cleanse itself naturally with saliva. So if you're taking a drink every 20 minutes, it's as though you're bathing your teeth in this all day long.
What's the youngest kids that you treat?
Sometimes three-year-olds, three, four-year-olds that have a lot of tooth decay in. And those are usually what we call baby bottle tooth decay, and that's from having juices in the baby bottles. And sometimes it's from having soft drinks in the baby bottles, too.
Do you do the majority of your treatments in Kentucky?
Yes, yeah.
Okay.
It's eastern Kentucky, the Appalachian region, the mountains. That's the poorest region in the state. It's directly related to poverty.
Yeah.
It's pretty common for people around here to drink a lot of pop. Mainly it's Mountain Dew and Pepsi.
This is 17-year-old Larry. He's lived in Kentucky all his life. This is his tat, this is his favourite t-shirt, and these are his teeth.
My 18th birthday is in 8 days, and I mean, people look down upon me because of my teeth. As I was a kid, I was never worried about my teeth. Yeah. And I would just take a pop everywhere I went, and I always had one in my hand.
And how old do you reckon you were when you had your first Mountain Dew? Like, how old?
I would probably say 2 or 3.
And how much a day would you say you have?
I would say at least 4 or 5 bottles. If it was cans, I would say at least a 12-pack.
12 cans a day. Is that the people doing that in this town? Is
yeah.
It? What about you talking about your cousin before?
I would say about 6 or 7 cans a day. And he's only 3 years old.
And how does he, drink it from the can?
No, from the bottle. She puts it in his bottle.
Edwin is meeting Larry today because he plans to remove all of his teeth and replace them with dentures.
He has 26 teeth that need to be extracted altogether. I'd like to say that that's really rare, but it's not. You doing okay, Larry?
Yeah, I'm pretty good. Nervous.
Okay. You got any questions about today?
Yeah.
What?
When can we get this started?
Can we get his mama here?
I don't want no pain for him. I wish I could take it for him.
Well, right now Larry doesn't feel numb, and I think we have a couple factors playing a role in that. One is that he's very nervous and the adrenaline's flowing. And the other is that he has infection in there and has had infection for some time, so the anesthetic does not take effect as well. The condition his teeth are in now, you know, he suffered a lot before he's even been here, so he knows what pain is.
Due to infection, no amount of anesthetic would work on Larry's gums. So Edwin has decided to postpone the procedure for another day. When contacted, Pepsi said that in moderation, Mountain Dew is part of a healthy, balanced diet. But I would argue that any drink with that much sugar and caffeine in it is quite difficult to have in moderation. In fact, despite sitting through Larry's ordeal, the biggest shock came when Larry told me that he still loved Mountain Dew and would continue to drink it.
Hi, honey. Oh, it was an amazing day. When you think of Armiter and now this, you go, you're seeing the direct effects of what sugar's doing. And the companies, they just don't see it because they're worried about making money. They're not on the ground level seeing the effects, and they don't care, really. And I spoke to the dentist about like what Pepsi have done about it and stuff, and he said, oh, look, you know, they contacted me and said, look, we really want to help you out. And, you know, so they bought an RV, another car to help with the kids. But he's like, look, yeah, that's good, but they don't really need an RV. They need education. But as he said today,
they need to not drink Mountain Dew every day.
But as he said, they're not going to educate the kids because that means they'll stop drinking, and that's a disaster for them.
My experience with Larry led me to a Pulitzer Prize-winning author, who has written extensively on how the food giants have got us hooked on their products.
You can't underestimate the amount of scientific effort that these companies will put into maximizing the allure of their products. Understanding the sort of fundamentals of how we taste and why we crave and what makes food addictive. And I was lucky enough to spend some time with a legend in the processed food industry. His name is Howard Moskowitz. And he walked me through his recent creation of a new soda flavor for Dr. Pepper. He started with 61 levels of sweetness in the formulation, subjected that to more than 3,000 consumer taste tests around the country, then took that data and out came the optimum level of sweetness that was guaranteed to send their new soda flying off the shelf.
Behind the closed doors of industry, this optimal amount of sugar is referred to as the bliss point. Back in the 1970s, Howard Moskowitz discovered that as you increase the amount of sugar in a product, people liked it more and more, but then they peaked. And if any more sugar was added, then they stopped liking it.
So I discovered the bliss point, and that's what it was christened, the bliss point. Well, fast forward 45 years later, it means pasta sauce, it means sodas, it means cereals.
Creating bliss points in products all over the place is exploiting the biology of the child. You know, it's created this expectation among kids that everything they eat should taste sweet. So when you get to the vegetable aisle, right, and you're trying to get little Mikey to eat that broccoli, and he starts tasting those bitter notes, right, instead of sweetness, you know, you're in for a load of trouble as a parent.
It's understandable that our palates have adjusted to all of these blissed out foods when we have such a primal desire for sweet. Even Mother Nature herself has created a berry that makes everything taste sweet.
So in front of me, I have three food items that it's fair to say I don't enjoy. This here, piping hot chili. This here, sour lemon. And this nasty bottle of apple cider vinegar. But apparently, if I put this miracle berry onto my tongue and then eat those things, it's supposed to make them taste sweet. No way! That's an orange.
I'm dubious.
When I hit my throat, it was really intense. But in the mouth, I don't know what it tasted like. Maybe lemonade kind of thing. It wasn't too sweet, but it was not apple cider vinegar. But this has got me nervous. I do not like chili at all.
Please work.
Nothing. In my throat, though. There's no miracle berry on my esophagus. Damn.
This experiment with my taste buds made me realize what the food companies have always known, that adding sweetness can make anything palatable.
I'm so sorry.
Well, almost anything. It was now day 35, and the rule of the experiment I was finding increasingly hard to maintain was exercise. My motivation had plummeted.
Hello, Sharon.
How are you feeling?
Oh, well, if you could see me, you would not recognize me because there's a few pimples that have arrived. There's a lot of fat and fullness in my face, and my tummy is really quite something to behold. I can't fit into my favorite new shorts anymore, which is a bit disappointing.
When did the pimples break out?
About 3 days ago.
It's probably your liver reacting. Often skin conditions are related to poor liver functioning.
So if someone's on a sort of like high processed sugar diet, you'll see it in their eyes, you'll see bags under the eyes, you'll see it in their skin, whether they're here or they're just really drawn and lethargic.
Sugar's effects on me physically were obvious, but my cravings for it and the mental toll it was taking prompted me to explore what it was doing to my brain. So I took my pimply face to the Oregon Research Institute. This group of scientists, who I'm trusting enormously, own this colossal magnetic sucking machine called an fMRI, which they are going to put me and my brain into. They will then show me images of this high-sugar, low-fat milkshake and then feed me the milkshake through a special mega straw. Then they'll take some photos of my brain and show me how it reacted. Step is that we see what's called a cue or a trigger, which in my case was the milkshake. It can be a picture of one or the real thing. Now, when we see this sugary cue or trigger, a chemical called dopamine is released in our brain. This is an evolutionary urge when sweetness was rare. So when we saw it, our brain said, get that, because you need it for quick energy and to feel good. Now, the next step is that we get the sugary item. We bring it to our mouth and we taste its sweetness. It's then that chemicals called opioids, beta endorphins are released, and we feel terrific. Sugar lights up the same reward areas of nicotine, cocaine, and sex. But it doesn't last long. Now, if some of us eat sugary foods often enough and establish this happy feeling of reward, it can create subconscious or mindless habits, which are easily triggered by more images of sugary foods. Throw into the mix that the fructose half of sugar also affects our appetite control centers, plus the glucose half affects our moods. And suddenly, we have a very volatile combination on our hands.
One of the very interesting emerging findings in this literature is the more you eat high sugar foods, the more you're going to desire high sugar foods and want to continue eating them.
Give me that old-fashioned morphine.
This desire to want to keep eating more sugary foods sounds a lot like addictive behavior.
Give me that old-fashioned morphine.
Serge Ahmed, who's now in Bordeaux in France, published a really cool study where he basically showed that rats will work harder for sugar than they will for cocaine.
Unlike the drug dealer who is, you know, is squired away someplace hiding, the food giants are in your face everywhere you go.
In the boardrooms of these food giants, addiction is a dirty word. When it comes to obesity and illness, the food industry have always argued that people need to take personal responsibility for their food choices.
When it comes to eating,
fat people are basically very stupid.
But you see, I was away this weekend, and it is difficult in friends' houses.
Okay, Mrs. Wright, I can't no say more chocolates.
For more than 50 years, the food industry has insisted that obesity is caused by too many calories and not enough exercise, which implies that anyone overweight is simply lazy or greedy. Okay, so we just passed halfway, and I've never counted calories in my life. I'm trying my best in this experiment. It's hard to be accurate, obviously, but it looks like my calories so far are pretty much exactly the same as they were pre-experiment. And that feels strange because I feel like I'm eating a lot more, but I can see here that when I was eating pre-experiment avocado and nuts and stuff, there's a lot more calories in fat than there is in sugar. So in fact, it's half, like 9 calories per gram of fat, whereas sugar's only got 4 calories. So I can see why we're told that sugar's okay and don't eat fat, because there's less calories. But I'm eating the same amount of calories as I did before, but my liver's turned to fat, my belly's chasing my ladies, it's doing something in my brain, we know that now, and I'm not feeling full. So it feels like the calories from sugar behave very differently to other calories.
Sugar industry absolutely depended on this idea that it's just about energy balance. Because if there's something uniquely deleterious about sugar, then they're in the realm that cigarettes are in, tobacco and lung cancer. But if it's just about eating too much or not exercising too little, if a calorie of sugar is no different than a calorie of broccoli, they're fine. Just tell people to moderate their weight. If you're getting fat, eat less, and that's all there is. So the sugar industry also sort of pushed this idea that a calorie is a calorie is a calorie, and yet these calories do dramatically different things in the human body, and they always have.
It's become clear to me that in the search for profits, the food companies are not only targeting our primal desire for sugar, but are also insisting that all calories are equal. The result is that we feel like failures if we're addicted or overweight. Perhaps the greed that is actually making us overweight and sick is of the corporate variety.
Hello. Can you show me the belly?
This baby. He's actually doing little kicks.
Quick. Oh. Hello, baby. Hello, baby.
Hello, daddy.
Bye.
Love you. Bye-bye. Bye.
How many sugarholics there are in this country? Millions and millions of them. As you go around the schoolyard, you watch the young boys and girls of this country and see how many of these children, they're soft, weak muscles, they're out of condition, they don't have the energy and vitality they should have. They look like sugar. They don't.
After 45 days, it became more and more evident that we're just not getting a clear message about sugar. Could the fact that sugar's global trade is worth $50 billion have anything to do with it? It turns out that the suppression of the message began in the 1970s, when the US government was reviewing the safety of sugar for the first time. The Sugar Association launched a campaign to ensure their product wasn't vilified.
In this case, what the sugar industry did is they stepped in when the evidence was ambiguous, and they said, we're going to kind of make sure it's always ambiguous.
To do this, the Sugar Association paid scientists, hired a PR company, and released a report with a press release that read, "Scientists dispel sugar fears."
They put out this document called Sugar in the Diet of Man. There's no sign that it was paid for by the sugar industry. It looks like a very official document. It's published in a journal. They said sugar industry sends out 25,000 copies.
This report was then used by the government to determine its findings. Sugar was exonerated, and the rest of the world followed suit.
Jack Tatum, president of the Sugar Association, is presenting to his board, and he says, look, there is no conclusive evidence linking sugar to these chronic diseases, and this is the lifeblood of our organization. It's the lifeblood of our product. If anyone ever links sugar to these diseases, we're dead. So our job, what we have to do, is make sure that there's no consensus.
This manipulation of evidence and deliberate muddying of the waters is all sounding very familiar.
Okay, how's about taking a nap? Hey, I got a better idea. Let's take a Winston break. That's it! Winston.
And evidently, it's still going on today.
If you create a list of the things that the tobacco industry did to stall or to fight off public health actions that would curtail smoking, the food companies are doing every single one. Paying scientists to do studies that favor industry positions, paying money to professional organizations like heart-related and cancer-related organizations, putting out deceptive statements in the press, characterizing science that doesn't work out for industry as junk science. You know, there's a very long list of these things. Tobacco industry did them all, and the food industry is doing them all.
Many of the reviews, that the final review is that there is no evidence that sugar is associated with metabolic disease of any kind, are funded by the sugar industry.
Given everything I've learned so far, it was hard to believe there are still scientists defending sugar and fructose. I was curious to meet one of them.
I haven't eaten sugar for nearly 3 years.
Yeah.
And part of this film is that I'm for 60 days eating a very high fructose sugar diet.
Yeah.
I thought maybe I'll put on a little bit of weight. I put on 6 kilos in Australia, which is 15 pounds.
Right.
All hidden sugars, granola bars, low-fat yogurt. What's happening?
Well, what I'd say is that that's a very powerful anecdote. And I think, you know, it's... I think that's true, can be true for a lot of people. But I would say that you have to be careful anytime you do a high amount of anything. I think if I was to put you again on a white bread diet, you know, or to put you on a crisp, you know, potato chip diet or a French fry diet, you might have a similar effect. I think the issue is that all of these calories really need to be regarded as discretionary.
I found John's position on calories so similar to the line that the food industry takes that I felt compelled to question the source of his research funding.
Have you ever received any kind of funding from Coca-Cola?
You know, I think this is a really important question, and it's very important for me that I be transparent. So we've received investigator-initiated, unrestricted funding from Coca-Cola. What that means is they had no say over our questions we were asking, how we conducted the research, our analysis, our interpretation, and our data plan.
It's a red flag for me to hear you even say that. It's like, whoa, yeah. Okay, because this is a company with 650 beverage
You're
products.
Right. You're right.
Rely on fructose and sugar. Yeah. So
what I would say is you're right. I mean, we realized this going in. I mean, some may view this as sort of shaking hands with the devil, I guess. I mean, even though that's the case, you know, we're confident enough in what we're doing in our protocols and we're laying everything bare that we could, you know, afford to engage with them.
I think we should not take money from the industry directly. I think it's just morally wrong to do that. And, you know, money is tough. So it's a big dilemma for researchers as well. But we don't want to taint the answer. We want to know the truth.
Just 1 week later, I saw an ad for a symposium on fructose and sweetened beverages. It was sponsored by Coca-Cola. Their keynote speaker was Dr. John Sievenpiper. He spoke about calories, and there being no link between fructose and cardiometabolic diseases in the studies. Coke madly tweeted about it, and then the host asked the audience
to maybe put together a YouTube video to, you know, bring some balance back to those messages that are out there for the public.
I found this video on YouTube, but I'm not sure it's quite what they had in mind.
Берем обыкновенную Coca-Cola. Напиток многофункциональный. помогает во всем.
As the US leg of my experiment neared its conclusion, what really struck me is that despite all the effects sugar is having on us, in many ways, we've just adapted to its saturation.
And I'm just noticing how incredible the human body and the human mind is, because even though I'm having 40 teaspoons of sugar a day, I've adjusted now to this new reality. My body just accepts that this is what I eat, and my brain deals with the moods up and down. I just get on with life and it's fine, I can function. But I'm not nearly as efficient as I was. My fuse is a lot shorter. I'm exhausted. And I think that's how a lot of people live their lives. People are up and down all day, but it's just their reality, so they accept it, and they've never experienced anything different. And I have, and I'm really excited to get back to that point.
If you've always lived this way, you have no idea what life can be like. It's not part of your frame of reference. Just the sound.
Now, a lot of people will say, well, I eat sugar all the time and, you know, I'm perfectly fine. Well, what they don't understand is that they eat sugar all the time and they're fuzzy and their mind is cloudy all the time.
Sugar has now become so deeply ingrained into the fabric of our society that some people can't imagine life without it.
Let's say we took away added sugar. Well, then what are people going to do to get that same feeling in their life that sugar gave them in terms of their values and preferences?
But we forget that we didn't always live like this.
Society has changed. 200 years ago, there was not a society in the world when they had a festival that was basing what they ate and what they drank on sugar.
Today, it has become synonymous with any celebration. But more profoundly, it is one of the simplest ways we communicate love.
I think the reason that sugar has become so ingrained is that it actually evokes love. Our brains respond to the chemical effect the same way we respond to love.
If we're feeling upset, what do? We have some sugar, oh, I feel better. There's not enough sweetness in our life, not enough love. Oh, I'll just have some chocolate.
With sugar having such complex associations with our hearts, minds and bodies, I wonder if it is having far greater ramifications for the culture than we've considered.
Rudolf Steiner said that sugar essentially causes materialism. And that development of the sugar metabolism and the sugar drug culture developed a materialistic culture.
We live in a time of instant gratification. Nobody wants to wait for anything. What's sugar? Quick energy, straight to the brain.
Too. Look at that.
Oh, let's do it.
After 60 days and 2,360 teaspoons of sugar, it was time for the last meal. I thought it would be fitting to cram all the remaining 40 teaspoons into items that could be found in a child's school lunchbox. One week later, after having all my blood tests done, I assembled the team to hear the final verdict on what sugar had done to my body. The obvious place to start is the liver. A key marker for determining liver health is a hormone called ALT. In the first month alone, mine jumped from 20 below the safety line to 20 above the safety line.
So it took you from, say, the best 20% of the men in to the worst 10%
in 1 month.
In 1 month.
Fatty liver is the first step towards insulin resistance. So once you're on an insulin resistance pathway, then you're on a pathway towards type 2 diabetes and then ultimately insulin-dependent type 2 diabetes. Today in Australia, 9 people had a limb amputated to that disease.
My triglyceride levels, which is the fat in the blood, went from a healthy 0.08 to 1.5.
So you'd hit the risk point.
Gee whiz.
In 2 months of healthy eating.
Healthy eating.
High triglycerides can also indicate a switch from healthy cholesterol to the damaging small dense LDL cholesterol.
Small dense LDL lines you up for heart disease because they're the ones that are embedding in the arterial walls, forming plaques, and that's the bit you don't want.
Yeah.
Have all the LDL you like, but don't have those.
Yeah.
In terms of weight, I gained 8.5 kilograms overall and added 7% to my total body fat. But more ominously, increased my waist measurement by 10 centimeters. This is the dangerous visceral fat. I showed a slight change in the bum expansion test, a variance in the rear flesh wings test, and had great success in the highly scientific belly slap make a fat wave wobble test.
I was quite, as you know, quite alarmed that you were able to do that in such a short amount of time. Again, eating heart-approved healthy foods that everyone's going along thinking, you know, is totally fine to be doing.
And we're worried about the future of this obesity epidemic in Australia, whether it's going to lead to an epidemic of liver disease in the long term.
But perhaps the most enlightening of my results was the calorie count. As I discovered, my calorie intake was virtually the same as my pre-experiment diet. The big difference was the source of the calories. I'd pretty much done a direct swap of healthy fats for sugar-laden products.
I was looking at the total calories as well, and very often it would come out as less than what he had eaten previously. The way that calories have been measured in the past needs to be re-looked at.
This calorie counting and this intense fixation with it, and it's our fault as much as, I take responsibility because that's a message we've been spewing out for the last 30 or 40 years, but we really have to try and turn things around. And Damon is living evidence, living proof. It is not the calories, it's the source of the calories, it's where they're coming from.
I'm surprised how quickly things went downhill for you. I honestly am. Yeah. To put on so much weight in just 60 days without really changing the number of calories you were eating, without, eating rubbish, to have such a big effect, 10 centimetres on the waist, 8.5 kilos on the body, full-blown fatty liver disease developed, well on your way to cirrhosis, well on your way to insulin resistance. That's a disaster.
I obviously, through my research, have convinced myself that sugar is almost assuredly the problem, like the fundamental problem. You get rid of sugar and everything else becomes relatively harmless.
We would like to do the definitive study, but even if we find out next month it gets funded, it's still going to be 5 more years before I will have results. What possible risk to public health is there in people lowering their sugar consumption.
This is our problem, and we should all work together to solve it instead of pointing fingers and not being productive about that. And I would love to see the food industry come to the table with scientists and healthcare providers and do what's right.
The first week of giving up sugar wasn't a lot of fun. Frankly, it didn't feel that different from giving up cigarettes. I had headaches, I was moody, and my sleep patterns were terrible.
And I just tossed and turned all night and then woke up very early, and as soon as I was awake, I kind of am craving sugar. I feel like I need a hit. It's the first real sign of that this is going to be a bit tricky.
But I knew from previous experience that I wouldn't feel like this forever, and that ultimately it would all be worth it.
Because food and sugar has a very strong emotional component, then we have to heal ourselves emotionally. We have to go through what could be a disturbing experience or an uncomfortable or even awkward experience coming off of it.
But once you get through it, which is about 2 to 4 weeks, suddenly the desire for sugar disappears altogether.
1 month after finishing the experiment, a miracle occurred. Our daughter was born. This is her mobile, this is her teething giraffe, and this is her lunch.
Oh, yeah.
But then some other remarkable things happened. After just 2 months of cutting out sugar, my vitality had returned, my skin was brighter, and thankfully, my moods had evened out.
I've had hundreds and hundreds of people go off sugar just for the reason of clearing up their mind. And typically the result I get is, wow, I had no idea.
In terms of my weight, all I did is return to my pre-experiment diet. I swapped cereal and low-fat yogurt for bacon, eggs, and avocado without toast. I snacked on nuts and cheese instead of muesli bars, and ate fish or meat with the fat left on, and lots of green vegetables for dinners. I lost 6 kilograms with minimal exercise.
Once you remove that hormone disruptor, fructose, from your diet, your appetite control works again and your weight drops.
Because I replaced sugar with healthy fats, I felt full again and didn't have to eat as much. Consequently, I spent the same amount on shopping as I had during the experiment.
Whenever you walk into a supermarket, make an immediate right turn or left turn for the produce aisle and avoid everything in the middle. Everything in the middle is a huge amount of calories with very little nutrients. And what we want to do is reverse that.
But the biggest surprise was that all of my blood tests had returned to normal. So no more heart disease risks and no more fatty liver.
I think the most important message is that this is not you get a fatty liver and that's it. It will stay fatty. It actually can be reversed very easily by taking away the fructose from your diet, taking away all those drinks. I mean, water is a good drink.
Yeah.
In truth, Mommy's pie. It did take a while for my palate to readjust to my lady's unsweetened cooking. Things tasted bland for the first few weeks, but then I rediscovered the full flavors of fresh produce. Mm.
For just 5 days, I want you to discontinue or take out of your diet for 5 days these foods that I'm going to show you, and I promise you that you will feel 100% better. Will you please try this for me, just an experiment, because I'm here trying to help you. You help yourself a little bit. White sugar, candy, cake, ice cream.
In the USA, it was recently recommended for men to have no more than 9 teaspoons of sugar a day, and women no more than 6. Australia currently doesn't have an equivalent recommendation.
I love chocolate. I eat a little piece of chocolate every day, but I'm careful.
And I understand the adverse effects if I have too much of it.
But for me, it's simpler to cut out sugar altogether. And that means avoiding artificial sweeteners too, to keep the cravings alive.
If you continue to reinforce, it has to be sweet in order for it to be good, then you're never really learning how to do food, good food.
I want my daughter to grow up healthy and happy and not waste any of her precious time counting calories or obsessing over weight. By educating our children, perhaps they can avoid the mistakes that our generation has made.
Do whatever you can to turn fruit and vegetable into the highlight of your meal. Train your kids to love them.
That's what every parent's got to figure out. How do you get in all those great nutrients? How do you get those superfoods into your child and make it taste good at the same time without spiking their blood sugar? So that they can sit down and study and learn and allow for the creation of genius. That's why we're having the sugar experiment. We had to learn that this is not the right way to go in order to help inspire us to get to the next level.
I certainly don't think that sugar is solely to blame for all our current health problems. But given its prevalence in our food supply, lowering our consumption is a great place to start.
Sugar's not evil, but life is so much better when you get rid of it.
This experiment has proven to me that refined sugar and excess fructose are causing serious damage to the health and well-being of millions of people. And as the debate heats up and the food industry fight tooth and nail to shut the message down, we'll be bombarded with conflicting nutritional advice. But for me, quite simply, the proof is in the pudding. About 10 teaspoons of it.
Gonna be in any food that's pink. I'm confessing I'm addressing and I end up the bun with a cheeky corn syrup. Trying to steal all my fun. Muesli bars, eating some cigars, and a whole range of marmalade and honey jam jars.
Why is the sugar so ubiquitous? Our addiction to you is quite ridiculous. We feel so sick when you're not around.
That's why a spoonful of me helps the medicine go down.
Cheerios, hey my love, you're my get up and go. A sweet tooth that needs you, a craving so sweet that you could go. Inside a pinata,
sugar. You're like sugar.